first item are the minutes of our previous meetings. Do we have any comments to the minutes as presented in our package? I had one. No, I can't find it. On page 3, it refers in the third paragraph from the bottom as Mr. O'Meara. I think it should be changed to Ms.
One minor typo on page 7, the very last line, July 23rd, I believe, should be June 23rd.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Are there any other comments? Do we have a motion to accept the minutes as presented and amended?
So move.
I second.
All those in favor? Second by raising your right hand. Opposed? It's passed. Going quickly through correspondence that you had in your packages that we've received, we have a letter from Mr. and Mrs. Siepert, a letter from Carolyn Donovan, the minutes from the Conservation Committee's June 25th meeting, a memorandum from the Conservation Commission regarding Ram's Head subdivision, a memo from the Town Council Chair regarding the joint workshop on July 20th, memo from our town manager regarding setback variances, a memo from the town manager regarding paper streets, a letter from Tom Powers regarding Rosewood subdivision, a memorandum from the code enforcement officer regarding Stonegate Phase 4, and a letter from the fire chief regarding Highland subdivision. In addition to which, we have before us tonight a couple of additional pieces. One is a letter from T.Y. Lynn, the town engineer, regarding Rosewood subdivision. We have a letter from Richard A. Davis regarding Rosewood subdivision. We have a memorandum to Maureen O'Meara from Ernie McVeigh regarding Ram's Head subdivision. A letter from Mary Alice Riley regarding the Highlands at Broad Cove. And finally, a corrective page to our zoning ordinance. Now, Mr. Emery is going to be late tonight. Let's see, I want to make sure I get the right people working on the right thing here. We need to appoint, how about Tim Eichenberg for Rose, for Spurwink Woods, and Judy Lardner will appoint you for Rosewood if Tom's not here. Okay, so for the Spurwink Woods item, which is next, I will appoint Tim Eichenberg. This is first order of old business, Spurwink Woods, request by Edward Drinan for a one-year extension of time for a major subdivision review of Spurwink Woods, a 27-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Shevers and Macaulay Roads, in accordance with Section 16-2-84A8 of the subdivision ordinance. I see Mr. Drinan approaching the podium. Good evening.
Good evening, Chairman, Woman, and members of the board. I am Edward Drinan. I am requesting a one-year extension to the review process for Spurwink Woods. This extension will allow the project to be built on public sewer rather than on a combination of public sewer, individual septic, and a common septic system. Public comment on this project from both in favor, those in favor, and those not in favor has been universal in its desire for public sewer. If the planning board agrees to the extension, I will continue with this proposed modest low-impact development of 20 or less single-family homes in a designated growth parcel of land which, among other things, permits up to 83 affordable housing units. The planning board may feel that an extension will cause it some difficulty in reviewing a project which is governed by an older ordinance. That is understandable. I feel, though, that the citizens of our town may not mind seeing the planning board somewhat exercised in an old ordinance review. What they may not like to see is a proposal which, while allowing for planning board expediency, calls for any development other than a modest number of single-family homes. Now, the town council has stated that solving the sewer capacity problems in our town is its number one goal this year, its absolute highest priority. I'm in touch with the residents of our town who live nearby this proposed development. They all want it on public sewer. The town wants it on public sewer. The town wants it on public sewer from the outset, so that the developer will pay for it, and so that the town won't have to replace a common septic system, perhaps in our next generation, at the town expense, at a period when I feel that septic systems will be outlawed. I think the planning board and the citizens should be grateful that I have not pushed ahead with this development with its in-ground septic systems, but rather patiently waited for the council to fulfill its stated goal of not only allowing sewer, but making it compulsory. Now finally, I made promises in my neighborhood meetings with these nearby citizens. I told them that I would keep the proposal modest, a modest number of single-family homes, and I would do my best to meet their wishes and mine to get it on public sewer. I feel that an extension is the only way to do this. Thank you.
You're welcome. Do we have any comment from the board on this?
Mr. Dryden, this is a difficult issue for me, and I don't know where my colleagues are on the matter. I understand the arguments that you put forth, and I think you put them forth in a persuasive manner. I'm not so much worried about whether or not we have to review something under an old ordinance or a new ordinance, as much as I am concerned about the general policy of granting extensions almost ad infinitum. Now, I know that's a slight exaggeration, but this project was approved, public hearing was had. I mean, we've been on hold since July of 1990, which is 2 years this month. And although it may seem to be a harsh position in this situation, I guess my initial starting point, and I'd certainly like to hear what my colleagues have to say, would be that I would like to see us adopt a general standard of saying that we will not extend anything beyond 2 years. Just that seems to me to be an outside time. Maybe this is an exception to that particular something, even if we adopt it as a standard, but I just wanted to put my thoughts on record to begin with, and please don't misunderstand me. I have been generally supportive of the project all this time. I think it's a conflict between two quote-unquote policies. So,
thank you, Janet. Is there anyone else that wishes to?
Madam Chair. We're always bothered with extensions and what the right decision is, and this one has dragged on for a long time, at least 2 years. I think that the fact that the town council fails to act, and we just met last night with the town council to reiterate our top priority has not been there. It has been their top priority, but it has not found their top priorities as far as some of their actions. The fact that the town council fails to act, I don't think means that the planning board needs to be held at bay. You sort of present your letter in the form of a threat. Must be a night for threats. If we don't give you the extension, then you'll come present something that we don't like, higher density, lots of septic systems. I understand what you're saying. It's not a very persuasive argument in my, from my perspective. I said before, and I think the record will show that I did not vote in favor of extending this last time, and threats aside, to present us with something that we may not like. I just can't see that it's a prudent decision on the planning board's part to further extend this.
Thank you, Mr. Edsall. Do we have any other comments? Mr. Parker?
What is the realistic timetable for sewer capacity for the area?
There needs to be changes to the ordinance currently to allow Mr. Drynan to hook his development up to sewer, because right now, he just wouldn't be eligible for the permits. And that was discussed last night with the council. It's an issue of getting a report out of the Board of Sewer Appeals, and then that has to go through the normal process of an ordinance change, probably to the council and the ordinance committee. And it's at least a couple of months, absolutely at least a couple of months in the future. And it depends on, there was some discussion about how to structure the costs of things. It could take a while.
You have any more comment? Ms. Gardner?
In general, I'd like to echo, I think, what Janet McKay has mentioned about these extensions. We've talked about it before, and I'm not in favor of them generally. If the board is of a mind, if the majority is of a mind to grant an extension, perhaps a shorter period would be in order. And if the council is really not able to take action because of other items we know were a priority, such as the updating of the comprehensive plan, I think at some point this needs to end, for what that's worth.
My turn. It's funny, we have before us tonight an incredibly full plate of some really interesting applications. I don't think there's anyone on the board that's probably wrangled over any one of them as much as we have over this. I know I have, because I'm caught, as I think the rest of us are, on the philosophical horns of a dilemma. Number one, I think we, speaking for myself, I envision the town as having shot itself in the foot when you came before us a number of years ago with an innovative and interesting proposal for that parcel of land. For whatever reasons that didn't go through, you came through with another. I think the Sperling Woods is a beautiful, it's an absolutely gorgeous piece of property, and it worked well with it. I hate to see, I know what you're looking for, I hate to see developers, big developers or small developers, put through anything more than they really need to. But I'm caught on that. What's an extension? Is it an extension or is it an extension? The other part is the, and I'm sure the rest of the board feels, is the philosophy of the extension. You know, the reason we're still extending it is because of certain ordinances that you would be reviewed under. It would be grandfathered. Now you have to go into something different. And at the risk of whatever may be proposed on this parcel of land within the next year or 2 years or 3 years or 10 years or 20 years, my feeling, I think, is to deny an extension at this point. But it's I do have strong feelings both ways. Any further questions? Comments? Do we have a vote, please?
Can I respond to the...
Of course you can. I'm sorry.
Of the members of the board.
I'm sorry. Of course.
I'd like to respond to a couple of things. Number one, Mr. Edsall's comment that his characterization of my letter to the board is a threat. I find that appalling, and it's merely realistic. This is a piece of land that's in a designated growth area of our town, and if you as a planning board don't want to go ahead with a plan for that piece of land, you are throwing it open to a questionable development in the future. By questionable, I mean, who knows what will happen there. So I do not agree with Mr. Edsall's characterization of my letter to you. And the only other thing I'd like to say is that I fully believe that your vote on an extension should primarily ask the question, who does an extension benefit? I think that the party who benefits from an extension in this case is not the developer, but the citizens of the town. That's all I have to say.
That's a good comment, thank you. We have a motion, if there's no further discussion.
I have a motion for the board to consider findings of fact. One, Edward V. Drynan is proposing Spurwink Woods, a 17-lot subdivision of vicinity of Shervis and McCullough Roads, which requires a review under Section 16-2-4 of the subdivision ordinance and the pre-May 1990 wetlands regulations in the zoning ordinance. The application is deemed complete, was deemed complete at the April 17, 1990 meeting of Planning Board, and the public hearing was held May 15, 1990. The application review period has been extended from July 1990 to this meeting in order to give the applicant time to revise the application plans in anticipation of possible ordinance changes. No revised plans or materials have been submitted for the Spurwink Woods project. Number five, the most recently submitted plans do not substantially comply with the standards of subdivision ordinance 16-3-1 or the pre-May 1990s wetlands regulations in the zoning ordinance. Therefore, be ordered, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Edward V. Drynan preliminary subdivision review and pre-May 1990 wetlands authorization permit for Spurwink Woods, a 17-lot major subdivision located off Shevers and McCauley Roads, be denied.
The motion, and Mr. Edsel, I'd also like to suggest one final findings of fact, see if you will accept this amendment, and that would be that number six, the applicant has requested a one-year extension until July 1993, and as a matter of board policy, general board policy, not to keep any item over longer than 2 years, the board cannot agree with this request. You may not want to accept it, I'm simply proposing.
I think we're stating that we cannot act when it's not a general policy. It may be a general consensus of the board that we don't wish to. I don't know that it's any set policy, whether general.
Well, we can adopt it as a policy.
I knew that that's what you're trying to put in there. If we're simply trying to set precedent on how we treat extensions, and your wish is to set some type of precedent. And you feel secure with your legal background that that's a reasonable amendment, I'd accept that to be amended to the findings of fact.
Thank you.
Do you have any additional comment? In case all those in favor, signify by raising your right hands. All those opposed? And all those abstaining? It passes four, none against, and one abstention. Thank you.
Thank you for your long and thoughtful consideration. I'll look forward to my next appearance before you in the civil ordinance change.
Thank you. Next, we have Mr. Joseph Rustacci with his Rosewood subdivision. Mr. Rustacci is requesting minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit, and a public access waiver for Rosewood, a 5-lot subdivision located in the area of Woodland and Mitchell Roads. The application was tabled last month in order to resolve stormwater issues on Woodland Road. The application will be reviewed for compliance with Section 16-2-3 of the Subdivision Ordinance and Sections 19.3.9 and 19.4.2b of the Zoning Ordinance. And are you ready or not?
I'm getting there.
Well, Tia, we have, as I said, an extremely full agenda tonight, and I'm desperately going to try to get through it all, which is going to take nearly an act of God. So, speak quickly, expeditiously, succinctly,
and clearly.
In the meantime, I'm going to appoint for this discussion Judy Wagner as a voting member.
introduction, you mentioned that this was tabled last meeting so that we could resolve some drainage problems and to clean up some language in the easement and several of the other deeds. We had a meeting on the site approximately 4 weeks ago now with all parties involved. And I'm talking the city engineer, the property owner, Mr. Davis, my engineer, and the engineer of Mr. Davis's. And we have basically come up with a compromise that we reduced 4 or 5 months ago. Mr. Davis has sent a letter saying that he is not interested in any activity wrong on his property. However, we have come up with a partial solution, and that is to replace the culvert with another culvert to collect and drain more water, which will not interfere with Mr. Davis's property at all. He has agreed to that. Our public works director, Mr. Morrow, has agreed to it. T.Y. Moon has agreed to it, and I've agreed to it. So hopefully we will resolve this with the professional people. The lawyers have been busy working on language and easements and deeds, and hopefully this has been resolved. And I come to you this evening hoping that all my I's are dotted and T's are crossed, and we've satisfied the number of questions and concerns of the neighbors, the professional people, the board, and whoever else might have a say in this.
Thank you. We always know an applicant's really optimistic when they bring the Mylars. It's a dead giveaway.
Well, you want a quick meeting? I'm required to take a vote.
Thank you. Okay, just to bring our viewing public up a little bit, there was a compromise reached, and if I can understand the engineer's reports and whatnot, in essence there will be a swale on the northerly side of the road which will sort of act as a sort of kind of detention basin, perhaps slowing down or keeping the road from flooding, but the actual impact on the property on the southerly side, which is Mr. Davis's, will be minimal. There will be replaced the same size, I'm just presuming it's a better, newer pipe.
We're going from a clay pipe to a PVC pipe, which allows the water to flow swifter.
Good. Some of the other items that came up at the public hearing was Mr. and Mrs. Siepert came before, through their attorney, had thought that they might assert an action to quiet title against a portion of the road. They have withdrawn that and are accepting, it would appear, your offer of an easement with warranty covenants. Let's see, the drainage of us out of that performance guarantee, you've submitted an escrow amount account to their guarantee of, let's see, $98,000. Maureen, you're going to have to fill me in on this particular aspect. I'm not totally clear on it, particularly with respect to what we just received tonight.
Yes, I'd like to ask Maureen if is the $81,000 amount acceptable to the...
Yes. The 98 was based on a submission from the applicant that was not complete, and the engineer had to make certain assumptions. The applicant has provided a new estimate, which the engineer has reviewed. The new number for the performance guarantee is now $81,550.
That larger amount,
acceptable to you, Mr.
That larger amount of $98,000 also included work to be done on Mr. Davis's land, which now has been backed off.
Okay.
Am I in agreement with this? To get this thing going forth, yes, I am.
Thank you.
Entrance, you've made the change that we had requested. Lot 2 landscaping, is unclear whether the board requested pine trees or hemlocks. That was my fault. I was the one that threw that red herring in there. And I will let you, as far as I'm concerned, plant whatever you'd prefer, or the neighbors would prefer, to keep everybody as happy as possible on at least that particular lot. I did not finally decide. We got into whether it was going to be shady or not shady, or up or down, or this or that. Do we have any further discussion from the board as I railroad us through everything tonight? Yes? Maureen?
I would like to add, one of the neighbors of the project did make a request to me. They abut the turnaround, and their request was that Perhaps the board would consider a condition on the approval that no more trees than necessary for the construction of the turnaround be removed within the easement.
This has been our goal all along, to save as many trees as possible. I think I talked with Mr. Kane this evening, and I told him, I think there are just three trees that are going to be removed.
Just what?
There are three trees, approximately three trees will be removed.
Ms. McKay?
That, in that same area, Mr. Frustaci, I noticed that Mr. Powers, on behalf of the Cyperts, had suggested that, as far as the Cyperts were concerned, they would be interested in having that area in front of their house donated to the town and have the town be responsible for the clearance of it. I have no idea whether, turn it into a cul-de-sac, in other words. You're not familiar with that concept?
I'm not familiar with that request, no.
That request.
I remember reading that. It seemed at this point that a cul-de-sac would be awkward.
We discussed a cul-de-sac on day one, and Bob Mallory did not want the cul-de-sac. The policy in Cape Elizabeth is to have the hammerhead or the basic turnaround, which is, this turnaround has evolved from lengthy discussions from the right side to the left side, and this is past review from a number of people, and I think this was the best solution to save as many trees and to avoid as much blasting as possible. A turnaround would only, I think, attract more traffic down here, people parking and going into the woods, the pond area, and I think there'd be a lot of night activity. So I think that this way would keep it residential and eliminate a lot of future problems.
Thank you. We have any? Do you have something more? No. Any other comment from the board? Ms. Lardner?
I have quite a few comments or questions, and mainly just to wrap up some of the issues that have been outstanding. We haven't talked a lot about the blasting, other than a note has been added to your plans saying that there would be 1 million commercial liability insurance. And I know, I think it was Mr. Bates who had requested in person and in a letter his concern that that might not be adequate. And I put forth before and never heard from the board if there would be any favoring of a condition requiring that the applicant or his agent require or perform a pre-blast inspection of homeowners that so request along Mitchell Road, and perhaps videotaping would be appropriate. I wonder if that mightn't make those homeowners a little more at ease. If that's standardly done by the blasters, that shouldn't be onerous. If it's not, I think it's appropriate given the concern we've had of these abutters. Something for the board to consider. This is something I might have missed. I know you had done some water quality tests of the pond and you'd obtained those results. Have those been submitted to the town?
Mm-hmm.
And you have
yeah,
those?
Have.
Okay. Let's see. And I think this will be to our town planner. Right now, we've had a lot of changes with, for instance, the location of the turnaround primarily. As far as you know, we do have current easement deeds for the turnaround and for the public access areas. Is that correct?
Yes, we do have deeds. I've also recommended to the board a condition on the approval motion before you that those deeds be submitted, executed in a form acceptable to the town attorney, so that we've gotten everything, as far as we all know, everything is all in order. However, when it comes time to sign them, there's still an opportunity for our attorneys to take one last look and make sure everything's in order.
Okay. I guess the next bigger issue has to do with Lot 5. We've had a lot of discussion about that and concern from abutters with respect to draining and that the area is very wet. I think I'm speaking primarily to a letter we received from Carolyn Donovan, and I think Maureen, you would be the appropriate person to address this, but she had some comments basically regarding, she was looking toward the ordinance and indicating what might be appropriate to be developed there and what standards the board would have to respect and so forth. And it's my understanding that the only area that is affected is the Brayton soil, which is considered a resource protection, wetland protection zone, and not a critical wetland.
Correct. It's what we currently call a resource protection 2 a wetland protection zone.
And there is no buffer required around that area?
Correct.
So the placement of the building envelope right now in no way violates our wetland ordinance, and he is not requesting any sort of wetlands permit for that area of the development?
Correct.
Then my other question would be, is one could say, make allegations that that boundary is not a good boundary. We have had reports done by Al Frick and Woodlot Alternatives that both deal with that area, and they agree with that placement on the map. Now, staff, or does staff feel comfortable with that boundary as delineated? And I'm speaking mainly to yourself, the engineer, if they'd be involved, and certainly code enforcement.
Mrs. Donovan did come in again and take a look at the file and did look at the Wood Alternatives report. I believe what she had requested is that a field survey of where the boundary is be done. From what I can tell, that has been done. A high-intensity soil survey has been performed and submitted to the town for review by a registered soil surveyor. Also, we have received an assessment of wetland vegetation on the site by a wetland biologist. So the board still, if the board had serious concerns about the quality of that information, you do have an opportunity under the ordinance to hire your own expert at the applicant's expense and redo, essentially, that work. But I don't see anything in the information that's been submitted to question the validity of what it's been saying, which is that those boundary lines are shown on the map where they ought to be shown.
Okay, thank you. And I don't have any problems with that. I just wanted to clarify this because there has been a lot of discussion. I guess my final comment would be, and I'm not bringing this up to be obstructionist in any way, I do not intend that, but there were also kind of allegations about, isn't it interesting that this lot is 19.99 acres and DEP kicks in at 20, and I certainly wouldn't want to bring this up to slow Mr. Pistacchi down at this point, but if that does cause any concern, I know earlier things like the town tax map say 20 acres, and I certainly would not depend on that. Those things are not particularly accurate. But if there is any concern at all, I wonder if it might be appropriate as a condition of approval that the applicant verify with DEP that, in fact, their approval is not required or review.
If I can, I did speak with Don Kale in the South Portland DEP office. He had gotten a report from someone else who was concerned, and he asked me, do you have a stamp survey? I said, yes, I do. It's 19.99 acres, and we both agreed there were a lot of surveys of that size in the state, but that there wasn't anything that, as long as there's a stamp survey, he didn't seem to feel he had jurisdiction. I guess I don't use the DEP laws, and I wouldn't presume to tell people what they say. I would suggest, however, that I seriously doubt there's anything that the state site location law could do with this subdivision that the Cape Elizabeth town ordinances aren't already reviewing.
Okay. That would be all my comments. Thank you.
I'm just going to make one side comment to the 19.99 acres. Just from the work I do, it's amazing how many are 19.97, 19.98. We call them snowplow lots. When the snowplow comes by at the end of the year and leaves a little bit of gravel out front, you're over it. But again, if it's assigned, no. That's a joke. Don't jump up, sit down. This just means they're so close. But it is a signed, sealed survey.
I just want to make one point about that, is that this survey was actually done years ago before Joe bought the property, and the previous owners owned more, sold off some lots, and were left with the 19.99 for whatever reason. And a second point is that if it was 20 acres, this still wouldn't go to DEP because there's only four lots to sell to general public owner that he's retaining.
So. I know that too. That's it. I can quote that rule. Do we have some additional comment?
Madam Chair, I missed through this whole thing the fact that you have two different envelopes. One's a building envelope, one's a clearing envelope. And I think I understand what, can you just briefly, we're very used to dealing with building envelopes. We don't typically see clearing envelopes, just so that we know what the difference is.
Basically, it's so that the septic systems are not necessarily in the building envelope. Building envelope is for buildings only.
Mm-hmm.
Clearing envelopes you can clear for septic systems and some minor tree cutting for lawn area. And that's all laid out in the easements.
Okay. I still have some questions about the turnaround on lot 5. I think your intention is that, number one, it stays private. And I saw notes to the fact that it was to be to be maintained by the developer. I guess number one, the question to the applicant, is developer the same as declarant? Number two, the question to Maureen, is this what we typically see? We're looking also at the Highlands, and they have at least one hammerhead or a turnaround there, and it is an out piece of the lot. It is part of the right-of-way of the road. The legal description seems to give to the town the right of easement to maintain and clear if they wish. I understand. I guess, does that give us the right, if the developer slash declarant, if they are the same, for the town to go in and clear, maintain that turnaround?
Yes.
Okay. Number two, is the declarant the same as a developer?
Yes.
Lastly, public access waiver. Maureen, can you bring me back up to speed as to what are the issues we should be looking at for the Rosewood Drive? We don't have a turnaround at the end of that drive, is that correct? Instead of bringing my whole map out.
That's correct, but we do have turnarounds built into the driveways for each of the lots.
And those are acceptable to fire chief?
Yes.
Okay, I remember the letters. I guess I have no other questions right now.
Any additional board comment? In which case, can we have a motion from someone?
Mr. Chair, I will propose the following motion. Finding of facts 1. Joseph Rustacci is proposing Rosewood, a 5-lot subdivision located in the area of Mitchell and Woodman Roads, which requires minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers in accordance with Section 16-2-3 of the Subdivision Ordinance and Sections 19-3-9-3 and 19-4-2B of the Zoning Ordinance. 2. The application was deemed complete at the March 17, 1992 meeting of the Planning Board, and a public hearing was held at the April 21, 1992 meeting and reopened at the May and June meetings. 3. Easement deeds must be revised and executed in a form acceptable to the town attorney to protect conservation land, assure provision of pedestrian easements, and provide adequate access for proposed lots in accordance with Section 16-3-1, J, L, and Q, and Section 19-4-2B. 4. A performance guarantee is required to ensure that site improvements will be constructed to town standard and the approved plans in accordance with Section 16-2-3A8. 5. The proposed subdivision will have a minimal impact on stormwater runoff in the area. The board finds that there is good reason to waive the requirement that the project meet the 25-year storm standard. 6. Blasting will be required for the development of this project. 7. The application substantially complies with the requirements of the Subdivision Ordinance, Section 16-2-3 and Sections 19-3-9 and 19-4-2B of the Zoning Ordinance. Decision, therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Joseph Rustacci for minor subdivision approval, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers for Rosewood, a 5-lot subdivision located off of Woodland and Mitchell Roads, be granted subject to the following conditions. one, that executed conservation, pedestrian easement, right-of-way, and other deeds be submitted in a form acceptable to the town attorney prior to any alteration of the site. Two, that a performance guarantee be submitted in a form and amount acceptable to the town manager and town attorney prior to any alteration of the site. Three, that a pre-blast inspection of homes along Mitchell Road be conducted by the applicant or his agent. Videotaping of the property shall be included in the pre-blast inspection. Four, no more trees than necessary shall be removed from the turnaround easement on Lot 5.
Second the motion.
Any comment? All those in favor? I'm sorry, you've got to be,
I know we're trying to be timely, Duke, but I just had a question. I can't write and also listen at the same time, I guess. I caught in the finding of fact, the blasting finding of fact. Was there another additional that we don't have listed?
I added one very similarly worded to one we post last meeting, which I read as the proposed subdivision will have a minimal impact on stormwater runoff in the area.
Okay.
Therefore, the board finds that there is good reason to waive the requirement that the project may be performed by the response.
Good. Okay.
Any further comment? All those in favor of the motion as read and seconded, please signify by raising your right hands. All those opposed, it passes unanimously. Congratulations.
Thank you for your efforts and your assistance and comments. We hope that we can make this a subdivision that Cape Elizabeth can be proud of.
Thank you, Jim.
I know this is a public hearing, Madam Chairman, but my wife and I, not residents, Cape Elizabeth neighbors, want to thank the board and Ms. O'Meara for your kindness and graciousness. You've been good neighbors.
Thank you, Mr. Kane. I appreciate it. That's nice. Order of business this evening is Rams Head Subdivision, and as I've had to in the past, I am excusing myself from this and instead appointing Janet McKay as chairman. Chairperson, sorry.
Chair.
Okay. I don't know what I was asking.
Ms. Lardner, Mr. Eichenberg, I'll appoint you both as voting members since Tom Emery is absent and Judith Kane has recused herself. Good evening, gentlemen. Let me introduce this subject matter by saying that Shaw Spring is requesting minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers for Rams Head, a four-lot subdivision located at the end of Charles E. Jordan Road. The plan was deemed complete in May. A public hearing was held in June. Plan will be reviewed for compliance with standards of the subdivision ordinance, the wetlands regulation, and the public access waiver. Mr. Hare?
Well, I think what we'd like to do is, if no one has any objections, is we'd like to go through Maureen's memorandum point by point with me talking about some things. And we've kind of divvied them up, and I was going to go through and talk about the ones you know, that I'd like to comment on, and then Rick would get up and talk about the ones that he would like to comment on.
Fine.
And then we could either, how'd you like, respond point by point and go down the list or wait till the end? We're thinking point by point just so we're not...
Why don't we take it point by point? This is the first time we've really, I think, gone through it in significant substance.
Okay. And I guess technically we came here tonight seeking final approval. And we're optimistic of that and hopefully the discussion of these points will lead to that fact. Proposed streets, you know, I mean, we don't take any issue, and
correct.
I guess the street design, design details that the town engineer is placed on, wants us to place on the subdivision plans, on addendum one, or things like turning radii, just to make sure that they're...
And you don't have any objections, fine.
Landscaping, no comment on that.
Mm-hmm.
Off-street areas, no comment. Street layout, again, we're keeping it existing topography. Access to sunlight, block links, street names. I think what we're trying not to do here is name the private street that's not on our property. It doesn't make a lot of sense for us to name a street that's on the Sprague Corporation land. And I think what we like to do to assist emergency vehicles is just stick some identification signs out that fire departments use and just and either point to the names, you know, lots 1 through 3 and lot 4 to the left, so that when they get to that turning point, they know which way to go.
Let's talk about that a little bit, because that appeared to be the concern of the town engineer. Of course, we don't know how these people are going to be getting their mail. It'll be through a post office box rather than a street address.
And part of that, usually the mail is delivered right there at the mailboxes at the farm. I would imagine that you could simply...
Jim Murray approached me about either the number 1, 2, 3,
right.
At the end, and with arrows pointing.
Right.
That's all.
Okay. We hadn't given much thought about where people are going to get their mail. Right now, basically, it's delivered right up to the farmhouse. So there's a row of mailboxes there, approximately where you parked your car. You went for the sidewalk.
I was just trying to figure out what I would say once I got there, and I wouldn't know much of what lot one meant if I...
I was just saying lot one, referring to, there'd be, you know, Smith family or something to the left. And
okay, well, let's mark that particular point for comment, and
I'd like to come back to that later. Yeah.
Sure. Stormwater, the town engineers recommended additional details, you know, once again. You know, we don't find anything to comment on. We'll be happy to do that. We are installing and designing everything to meet the SCS standards, as he stated. That's just common practice. I'm gonna skip over Jill and let Rick handle that. Lot area. I did a takeoff on all the existing structures, and right now we have approximately 10.5% lot coverage on lot 3, and even with the addition of you know, just say for grins, a 4-car garage on that lot, we're not going to get anywhere close to 20% coverage. So, I mean, that's basically what that was going after. We'd be happy to put down on the plans, you know, lot coverage not to exceed 20%. You know, seeing that that's a part of your ordinance.
Mm-hmm.
Vehicular access, lots require public access waivers. The applicant has submitted easements to protect it. No comment there. Multiplex sidewalks, no comment. Natural features, I know that Rick talked about that. Scenic vistas, the same. Recreation, open space, and common space. I'm going to let Rick deal with those. Sewage disposal, the issue being, on some of the plans, it looked like some of the systems were closer than 100 feet, and one of them behind the annex building, we're showing that long linear one between the annex building and the ocean. Indeed, it is within 100 feet, and I brought Ernie McVane out there this morning, and we walked all the systems, and he's issued us a memorandum of
got a chance to... We simply got that on the podium tonight, and I'm not sure I've had time to fully digest it.
I barely had the time. I'll just kind of summarize it. Lot 3 does contain two principal structures. Right now, we have an existing system, and it's connected to an approved overboard discharge system. And what we're planning to do is split the main house into one system and the annex into one system, thus eliminating a system that's about 30 feet away from the ocean and bringing the annex system back to 65 feet. And the one in front of the main house, where that cobblestone circular driveway was, is beyond 100 feet, measuring from the edge of the swimming pool that we're going to go through DEP and get filled in. We didn't tape it off, but it's somewhere around 100, 125 feet. It's well over 100. And Ernie said, based on that system wasn't in need of a variance. The one behind the annex was, and lot number 2 by the Pierce Cottage, we taped it off again, and we could easily move the system back 10 feet, 20 feet to make sure that there's no variance required, and Ernie was all in agreement with that. So in the one annex system, you know, we're definitely within 100 feet. Our feeling is that we're taking the situation and making it better.
Okay.
So flood hazards, again, no comment. Underneath the flood hazards, Maureen, you talked about the water a little bit, and all I could say is the water line will be installed 10 feet away from any septic system or sewage pipe, as required. Wetlands, again, no real comment there. Wildlife habitat, the applicant has proposed to restrict activity adjacent to a pond wetland system and to maintain a dune system on lot 4 as a conservation area. And no comment. Numbering of units, we'd be, you know, more than happy to number the units for fire department, emergency vehicles. Now that about sums what I was going to talk about. Unless you want to have comments for me based on those, or let Rick continue.
Tim?
Well, you know, we've proposed to restrict activity. It kind of seems that we've chosen to set all these buffers, and in reality, the state and federal regulations have restricted our activity based on the stream and the pond and the associated setbacks. We've further gone on within our lot design and restricted building windows much greater, you know, say for lot 1, our building window can be a lot bigger than this, but we have a location here that's perfect for a house. It's far enough away from the stream and the setback. We don't need to give somebody a huge building window. You know, we're kind of pointing them in the right direction. Lot 2 and lot 3, you know, based on the buffers, which are in light green, and the actual wetland, which is in dark green, you know, we're restricting activity. In here, lot 4, you know, we're restricting activity to the building unit. Now, the dune area, our intention there is to just, it's a hands-off approach, and based on, again, federal law, state law, municipal law, there's not much you can do to it, and we're just basically following that off, and, you know, our intent was to take away the gravel drive here, so there's not an attempt to get down there with a car, things like that, so... We're restricted by applicable laws versus coming out there and really setting a lot of, you know, self-imposed setbacks and stuff.
We've done that in the past by putting snow fencing up, restricting anybody from going on the dunes and replanting it. So that's kind of a continual thing that is self-policing.
Thank you. Well, perhaps we, in order to make this as easy as possible, I suppose, on the board, perhaps we could hear from Rick Chanet next with respect to his part of the thing, and then we'll open it up to questions from the board.
Good evening. My name is Rick Chanet. I'm a Bellman Drummond Woodson Plimpton McMahon. I represent Mrs. Sprague in this project. I'm sure that Brad could have just as easily dealt with these issues. We both want to earn our keep tonight, so that's why.
It seems to have demonstrated a preference for having you.
I kind of like the sexy stuff, so anyway. I do want to make one comment on what Brad said. I think that the language in Maureen's memo under wildlife habitat and other language in Maureen's memo is Maureen's language, not necessarily something we are doing. In other words, I think the proposing that we restrict activity adjacent to the pond and wetland system is a bit of a misnomer. We're not proposing to do that. We simply aren't doing it. We can't do it. We're not proposing to give up, or let me say, we're not asking the board to permit us to do anything in that area. We're simply not doing it. So I guess characterizing it as proposing to restrict activity is not the way I see it. It's simply, we're just not building over there, if you understand what I'm saying. I want to talk about a few of your ordinance provisions as they are discussed in the memo. And the first one I want to talk about is pedestrian easements. So I understand your ordinance provisions. I believe it's section 16.3.1 sub little j. The concept of pedestrian easements is something that the board may recommend to applicants. I interpret that as being discretionary on your part, and also more of a perhaps a request, an issue to consider, not necessarily a proposed condition to approval. In this particular case, plain and simple, while we appreciate the potential good that easements across private property might do for the town, in this particular case, Mr. Sprague would prefer not to grant any type of easements across any portion of the property for public access. There are no existing public rights now across his property to the shore. I mean, I guess primarily we're talking about access to the ocean. Again, the provision appears to be more cast in the form of a recommendation, an issue that will be discussed. Are you interested in doing this for the town? We simply would prefer not to do it for any number of reasons, not the least of which is we're not interested in opening up this property to the public in that sense. And that's about all I really would like to say about that now, and I'm simply asking, and I hope that the board is not suggesting that as a condition of approval, Mr. Sprague would be required to grant those kinds of easements. You need a podium that things don't slide off here, so bear with me. Natural features, item O on the memo, which I believe is triggered by provision 16.3-1, subsection O of your subdivision regulations. Brad has said, and I guess I would simply reiterate that the areas, the dune system, the wetlands are, as we all know, heavily regulated, both at your level, at the state level, and at least in the wetlands case, in the federal level. We're not proposing to do anything in that area. We are more than happy to live with, and we have to live with, the law as it currently stands with respect to what we can and can't do in that area. We aren't proposing, however, to extend limitations on what we can do in that area. While I have a hard time seeing any change in the law that would permit building on, say, dune systems in the future, I suppose it's a possibility. We'd like to be restricted as far as the law restricts us. We are not interested in extending restrictions, private restrictions, to
further protect land that's already adequately protected under law. And for similar reasons, the public easement issue, again, we're not interested in conveying those portions of the project to anybody else to maintain. They'll be part of our lots, they'll be maintained by the owners in accordance with law, and we'd like to leave it at that. So again, we would hope that the board will not condition approval of this project and require us to add additional restrictions over and above what your ordinance and state and federal law already mandate us to do. I'm not sure under item P exactly what is meant by your ordinance provision, particularly as it relates to considering design features such as building bulk, architectural style, and landscaping. The project is designed to take full advantage of the most significant amenity, which is other than privacy, which is the ocean and those views. And each lot and each building window has been thought out with the idea that hopefully the builder will build their house such that the primary view is towards the ocean. We don't see any possibility that building on the lots in those windows will create any adverse condition on any current scenic views that may exist. There are, as you well know, no public points other than the ocean from which one could look across this property to the sea. It's completely surrounded by, of course, the Sperry Corporation property. I'm a little troubled by the suggestion that the board might wish to have some say in architectural style and design. Shaw can correct me if I'm wrong on this, but I think his overall philosophy on this project is to, within reason, at this point, permit people to build the style of home that they want to build. We have some restrictions in the current draft of the declaration. It may be that we will expand those if we decide that maybe we do want to have, on his part, a bit more control as to what people build. I mean, he may not want a polka dot house there. I doubt very much whether anybody's going to build that kind of house. But again, I'm a little troubled, and I hope that the second sentence in Maureen's memo isn't intended to suggest that the board would like to require us to put further limitations on individual style. We don't think that the building windows as they currently sit and the type of homes and the location of those homes are going to impact on any views, historic landscapes, etc. You have a certain amount of control in terms of space and bulk under your ordinance, and we'll have that ability to control in that regard when people come for building permits. So I'm not sure what condition that might be triggering, but we would like the board to not to focus on individual style. Recreation and open space. Your ordinance 16-3-1, subsection Q, as I understand it, is intended to deal with a situation where a proposed subdivision is found to create a deficiency in recreational open space. It is cast in the terms of what I understand is an alternative requirement, either a provision for up to 10% of the land within the subdivision for a recreational open space, or the payment of a fee. It's my understanding that, in fact, no fee schedule exists, although the ordinance suggests that one has been adopted. In any event, the underlying premise for the requirement is to address a recreational or open space deficiency to be created by the subdivision. The ordinance provision, as you know, Romo goes on to talk about public access to passive and scenic recreation purposes, assuming these open spaces are created. We don't believe that this subdivision has any impact whatsoever in that respect. The lots, again, have been designed to maximize the most valuable amenity to the project, which is the ocean. Every lot will have direct access, obviously, to the ocean. They all have frontage. They have views. We aren't restricting lot views. We have no internal lots. We are really only talking about, while it's a four-lot subdivision, two of those lots are already built on. The house is already there. So we're really only talking about two new homes. Were we talking about two lots, we wouldn't even be here. Yet, the premise for the condition appears to be impact. Somebody building two lots isn't required to set aside open space, if you will. Yet, our situation with a total of two lots, or two lots that we built upon, apparently falls within the condition. So we don't see that this particular project creates the deficiency, assuming that the premise, again, for the condition is that subdivisions, depending on their size, their location, etc., have the potential to impact upon the public and open space recreation facilities for the town. And if you're going to create those sorts of deficiencies, the mitigation may be appropriate. We've internalized our recreation areas, if you will. We've internalized access to the ocean. We've internalized views. We have, with all due respect to wetlands, we have no net loss of open space recreation area as a result of our design of this project. So we would again request that the board not impose any kind of condition on this particular project, given its peculiar location and design and relative insignificant size, for us to put aside any kind of open space or recreational facilities beyond what we've already provided in the plan for the individual lots. Finally, the open space issue, the common space maintenance issue, item R of the memo. I believe at the last meeting, Ms. Laudner raised an issue about, were we going to create a homeowners association to maintain the pond, the wetland, and all that sort of stuff. Again, Brad has designed this project to avoid, as much as possible, with the minor exception of the road location, to avoid any sort of impact on the wetland, the dune system. Each lot will own a portion of that. It's not, those systems are not intended to be an integral part of the subdivision in the sense that they are significant detention basins, et cetera, et cetera. They're not, it's not like something we're putting in there to control drainage and that sort of thing. We think that as it is, given again your level of ordinance restrictions coupled with state and federal law, that there's enough protection already for the wetland system, the dune system, the pond, etc. It makes no sense to me to add another layer in the form of perhaps a homeowners association or to otherwise put further restrictions in the documents that duplicate what already exists in terms of protection for those systems. So we think we're okay there. Don't think we need to get into anything further with respect to protecting those systems. And would again request that the board not develop any kind of a condition along those lines. That's really all I have to say, but I'm sure I'll have to say more once your discussion ensues.
Thank you, Mr. Cheney. Questions from the board?
Madam Chair. I'm not going to cover all of this. Just to start with, just a couple of the issues dealing with this, with the naming of the streets and so forth. Well, I understand there's no need, or the field there's no need to name streets outside this four-lot subdivision, but it's a matter of health and safety issue to have street names, whether the occupants there choose to call it that or whatever. But I think the town needs to have street names to be given as reference, and would like to see the private ways named. The issue of the recreation, open space, and public pedestrian easement. As one board member, I don't see it as a question whether the applicant thinks or wants it to apply to their four-lot subdivision, regardless of whether it's two new homes or four new homes. I think it's a question that it is the town ordinance, part of our ordinance, that either public access is granted to that space or a fee is paid. The reason we don't have a fee is I can't think of in the last three and a half, four years of a subdivision where we haven't received the public access. There is some provision given to that, and just as one board member, I'd like to either see that the public access is granted to the conservation area, or a fee is agreed upon, and I guess that would have to go through the town council for the approval of that fee. One last question that I have has to do with a comment dealing with the building envelopes, and I don't have my plan out in front of me. The issue, and while somebody else is asking questions, I'll look into it, but whether the septic systems are actually inside those building envelopes. We all look at compromise in these situations. I think when we deal with scenic vistas, building envelopes have a real play in giving a reasonable level of restriction of development on a site. So I won't make any more comment there other than I think needs to be looked at.
Thank you, Mr. Edsel. Anybody else? Ms. Lardner?
I have several comments, some very basic. With respect to the lot area, Brad, I would like to see a note on, I guess it's lot 3, that would not exceed the 20% coverage, just to clarify that.
Sure.
You see, let me find some of the easier ones. On the comment T, flood hazards, if you could add a note on the plan, if it doesn't already exist, that the water line will in fact be a minimum of 10 feet from the septic system. I can't remember if that was on there.
Yeah, that's. I'll be glad to put that on there.
Okay.
And also, like Maureen said, we could easily dimension it too.
Okay. I guess I'd like to next then perhaps comment on the street names and the numbering of units. Certainly Ram Island Farm has been in existence with several dwelling units down there for years, and I don't know the number of units, but Breakwater Farm is a similar situation, isn't it, with several dwellings down there, and their address is Breakwater Farm. I would hate to presume right now to go in and start naming streets. I understand the fire chief or emergency concern about confusion, especially as we add new lots. They're probably very familiar with the existing homes down there and who belongs to those homes. I think it's very reasonable that we ask the applicant to approach the fire chief to sit down and say, quite honestly, we do not want to, or we cannot, whatever the situation is, name these streets and see what you can come up with that they feel comfortable with. I don't feel very comfortable putting some new houses down there and a lot owner calling or a babysitter calling and having someone not find the house in case of fire. That would be right. Quite tragic. But if you could come back with something that they agree to.
I mean, a simple thing could be we could just simply name the gravel driveways, you know, put a little sign right here and just name this gravel driveway, you know, something, and then name this driveway something.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'll
call it one, you know, X
I don't
drive.
Have a preference as long as there's something that the emergency person
yeah,
will
we'll be happy
with.
To talk to them and work something out.
I think that's all we're asking
yeah,
for.
Yeah, I know it's all you're asking.
And
I said I'll do it like three times. So.
And then it becomes part of the plan?
The naming? Sure, if only a note on the plans to yeah. whatever the agreement
well, whatever
is.
We come up with, we'll put it on the recording plan.
I guess then I'd like to get into this whole notion then of the pedestrian easements, the open space, the scenic vistas, in common space. I am certainly in favor of providing public access, providing recreational opportunities where they're lost and so forth. I also am a very staunch believer in private property rights. I would agree with Mr. Cheney's comment that there is not public access right now. There are some dwellings down there that will be increased by two. I would find it hard for anyone to argue that there would be a decrease in recreational opportunities for what are supposedly primarily the owners of lots within the subdivision. If one tries to levy a fee or require that you provide access that you really feel uncomfortable doing, I think the town would have to demonstrate very clearly that we need those opportunities. It's called a rational nexus test. If we're demanding that the applicant provide open space or monies in lieu of that, we have to clearly demonstrate that this particular subdivision is creating a need and that we are addressing that specific need. I also have a little bit of a problem, and Maureen can probably correct me on this, of using this as part of the green belt. It was my understanding that we were basically trying to link Crescent Beach area and the Great Pond and so forth, and we've got a map that shows proposed green belt areas.
We do have a map that suggests green belt areas, and its primary goal is to link Fort Williams to Crescent Beach. However, it's always been the position of the Conservation Commission and the Planning Board that other linkages would be acquired as they become available.
I can support that. I understand that, but I also fall back at some point when towns and states desire access or simply use, for instance, of the dune area, at some point pocketbooks need to speak. And perhaps rights be purchased if a demonstrated need is really there. Condemnation is always a town tool. If the developer could see any way to providing public access, I'm sure we would all be very happy. I would be hesitant as one board member, though, to try to require that. And I guess a final comment would be, I missed it before, on the sewage disposal. If you will revise the septic system location for Lot 2 on the plans before we approve it, and see how you can address the comment that the one on, is it Lot 3, would not be in violation if the pool was filled. Perhaps the DEP application just needs to be put in the works and you have to try that, and I assume if you couldn't obtain that, then you would get that waiver or variance, but something should be addressed perhaps before final approval.
Thank you. Any further comments? Mr. Parkhurst?
Yeah, just a couple comments. I too believe in private property rights and don't believe there's anything to be gained for the townspeople by having access within a private piece of property that they have no access to that access, at least at this present time. Lot 4, I would be in favor of more explicit deed restrictions on that just in case something does change in the future so nothing can happen to that dune area. And on the styling or architectural review, I don't think we have any right to require that for two new houses on a fairly large lot. And that's it.
Thank you. Any further comments? Mr. Eichenberg?
I believe that the section that we're talking about with respect to pedestrian easements is, and correct me if I'm wrong, please, is that section 16?
-3-1J, I think.
J. And is that correct, Maureen? That says that the provision of pedestrian easements or other types of pedestrian accessways not less than 10 feet wide may be recommended to the applicant. So we can recommend this to the applicant. It does not look as if we can require it from the applicant. Is that correct?
I wouldn't presume to tell the board that they couldn't require that as part of the subdivision approval, and I frankly have been instructed that this is something the board should look at carefully.
I think you just look at the last sentence of paragraph Q, which also addresses it. Land reserved for primary scenic or passive recreation purposes shall have, it doesn't say you might have, it says shall have sufficient public access as determined by the planning board. I just have an issue with, of a matter of consistency, when all of a sudden we don't think that there's, that we can show need in this four-lot subdivision here. I guess I'm really concerned about being able to go back to any other isolated or not so isolated proposed subdivision and say, yes, we have a need in this area where we don't have a need here. I think we're leaving ourselves in a real bad position if we're not consistent.
Madam Chairperson, could I comment on that?
Sure.
I agree with that. I wouldn't want there to be any perception, whether it's favoritism or just inconsistency on the board's part. But to take, for instance, Stonegate or Rosewood, which we just acted on, I think they're very different properties than what we're dealing with here. The Rosewood property, we've seen the system of pathways there. We've heard testimony that neighbors have, there's a history of use. I mean, there's a very long history of use. I've heard people quite old talk about, you know, 70s and 80s talk about how they used to ice skate on the pond as children. And Stonegate also, that whole area with Dyer Pond, shows there's a large trail network. It was my understanding that the previous large landowners knew that and didn't mind the public use of that property. And in both of those areas, Stonegate much more so, there was a lot more development proposed for those parcels. And one could argue that when you put in that number of units, where will those people recreate? I don't think it is fair to compare this project. I don't think that we put ourselves in jeopardy by treating this project differently, given that there is no history of public use. And
I guess I can just think of a long list of subdivisions where we fought and required public access easements and conservation area, where there was no more need than here. Okay. I think of Meadow, I can't remember the name of Meadow something, off Mitchell.
I would defer to your experience.
Completely isolated from any other, and here we have a public easement stuck here. I mean, it was well located for the Greenbelt area, but it was certainly not connected. We fought long and hard in Highlands for one area that did have use for recreational purpose. The other, we fought long and hard for a swamp area, which really, we agreed didn't have a lot of recreational use. We couldn't even walk through it. But we said, oh, we have a need for that. And I just can't understand why we wouldn't be more consistent when we are looking perhaps at a more exclusive area here than an area that may not be as exclusive.
Then could I add one final comment?
Sure.
Okay, not an argument. Then perhaps what might be appropriate, and I would certainly agree with, is if the board considers some sort of conservation easement, and maybe not a public access easement to the dune system. I mean, systems like that are very easily damaged by public access anyway, so that might be something else we would consider that may be more amenable.
I'd like to suggest that this is obviously an issue of some sensitivity, and that perhaps I understand from what the applicant has indicated so far that I suspect we'll be tabling this tonight. Is that the agreed conclusion after we speak?
Do we bring our mylars tonight? I heard that.
The mylars are ready. Our intention was to get this issue discussed and settled tonight.
I think we have some suggestions about additions to the plan that you have agreed to put on, so
right,
I'm not...
which are, you know, minor things, and it's our intention to try and get this issue discussed here.
I was going to suggest that perhaps the town planner do some thoughtful research about, you know, whether we've ever, I don't know what the history of the board is for the last whatever years, and perhaps that would have some bearing on what it is that we might choose to do in this case. But let's go ahead and proceed and see where we are at the end of the discussion.
Could I just
sure.
comment a bit more? I understand there's at least one subdivision in town where pedestrian easements were not acquired. I believe it's the Robinson Project. I'm told that. I don't know that for a fact, but I'm told that. I think it was a three-lot subdivision. I don't want to get into a discussion tonight about the merits of your provisions. I don't think it's appropriate this forum for us to get into legal issues raised by these sorts of provisions. But clearly there's an interpretation of these sorts of provisions that fall in the category of uncompensated takings. Mrs. Lodner, I don't know whether she's read the Nolan decision, but she apparently is familiar with it. I don't want to make an issue of your provisions. I'm simply saying that the provisions as they exist on their face, as I interpret them, permit the board to not impose these conditions. The pedestrian easement is cast in the form of a recommendation only, not a must situation. The open space issue is cast in the form of a requirement upon a finding of fact by this board, presumably that in fact an open space deficiency is created by this project. We don't think an open space deficiency is created by this project in any way, shape, or form, and I simply suggest to you that that's the case. So it seems to me that the board can be consistent in its application of its ordinance as it sits in its books now, on their face, applying them to this particular subdivision. What you have done in other subdivisions, I appreciate the desire for consistency. I don't think that should be and is appropriate to use as an application of your ordinances on each subdivision. Consistency is irrelevant. It's a project-by-project basis. Consistency in the application of the law is appropriate. Consistency of the application of the law as they relate to the facts before you is not necessary in the sense that if you find in this case, as we believe, that there is no deficiency, you need not require up to 10% of the project to be set aside. So I'm suggesting to you that your provisions permit you to consistently apply them and in this case find that they are not applicable.
Thank you. Mr. Eichenberg?
Yeah, there's a kind of a long gap between my first sentence and my second sentence.
I noticed that.
But
you were so graceful with that.
Didn't complain.
My second sentence was going to be that I would be interested in hearing about how this project, notwithstanding what we've just talked about, the takings doctrine and Nolan case and so forth, and now we have the Lucas decision to worry about, so we won't worry about that tonight, how this all relates to our open space plans for the town, the green belt system, and so forth. Would it be possible either tonight or at our next meeting to hear from somebody from the town that could give us some kind of an idea how this project might relate in the overall scheme of open space and the green belt system within the town of Cape Elizabeth?
Well, since you asked the question, I note that in the audience we have the president of the Conservation Commission. Is that your title, or the chairman, Jack? Would you like to say a few words? Identify yourself, please.
My name is Jack Roberts, and I'm the chairman of the Conservation Commission. We would like to look at this proposal for a pedestrian easement as something toward the future, not something that would be done immediately. Obviously, there is no public access to that particular parcel. However, it may be to the Sprague Corporation's advantage to put down an easement now so that when they are subdividing other parcels of land 10, 20, 50, 100 years from now, that this access is not cut off. It's much easier to do it now than it's going to be after the fact. The green belt, as has been indicated, the town council adopted a policy that to try to get green belts, pedestrian easements throughout all of Cape Elizabeth, so we weren't serving just particular neighborhoods, but all of the town, and that would be part of this desire as well. Again, I think the primary thing is that we would not mark this particular parcel if an easement was put down on it, because it does not have an ending and a beginning point. We have one that's coming up in the Stonegate proposal. There's one of the easements on that parcel does not have a terminus at the present time, but we are still getting that particular route with the hope that we can link into another area later on. Some of the areas that we're getting, we're not using immediately. We're not asking the developer, and the town is not planning on doing any marking until such time as it's feasible to do so and makes sense. Right now, it wouldn't. In the future, it may. So I guess we're asking you to look towards the future and not necessarily what's available right now down there. I don't know how many times that the land, I suspect is close to a third of the town, is held by the Sprague Corporation, how many 2 or 4 lot subdivisions they could do and not have any public interest in it. But the cumulative effect is going to be there. And again, I would like to work with them to develop something that they would be happy with and that would suit their needs as well as those of the town.
Thank you. Any further questions from the board or discussion? Ms. Lardner?
I guess just a quick comment with respect to what Jack has just said. I could support a pedestrian access easement perhaps along the oceanfront, and if there was some mechanism to protect this particular applicant, maybe a legal mechanism as opposed to simply saying we wouldn't mark it, that such pedestrian easement would not be used until it were to link up with other pieces. I still would have concerns about public access to the ocean because we have a tremendous public access in this town to the ocean. So, I mean, to, you know, a beach area.
At this point, we haven't even, you know, determined where a pedestrian easement would be on the parcel. Obviously, the ocean would make an ideal location, but it may just be a point that overlooks to that comes to the dunes and overlooks it, or a loop of some type. But again, whatever would work best in the development, and we'd want to work with the developer on that, not dictate where it's got to be.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any further comments, discussions? Mr. Hare, I just have a very few. I always try to read what people ask me to sign, so I did look at the recording plat, and I just have a couple of questions. On note 10, you're talking about new lawn areas to be established, but it doesn't preclude maintenance of existing lawn areas on lots 2, 3, and 4. Are there no lawn areas on 1 and yes lawn areas on 4? Is
correct.
That
the? Correct. Lot 4, part of lot 4 is mown. Lot 1 is hayed.
Okay. So that is accurate. You might want to pick up a typo on note 11, existing is missing an I.
Right.
And on note 14, what does it mean to say that this survey retraces a prior survey, but yet you say that it's also based on a survey dated July of 1991?
Right. Basically, what this is, our survey is overlying another survey that was done some years ago, and for up-to-date survey methods, we basically retraced it, checked it, and
but didn't revise
and sealed
it anyway.
Didn't revise the old plan at all. We're just stamping and sealing a new plan.
Thank you. I have no further comments. Anybody have a motion? Sure. Ms. Lardner?
Pose the following motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the
I beg your pardon. May I stop you for just a
sure.
moment? I realize that we have gone through the subdivision review process, but I'm not mm-hmm. sure we've commented on performance guarantees, wetland alteration permits, no. or public access waivers. So perhaps, did any of the board members have any questions about any of those issues? Yes?
Just a comment, and it could be perhaps addressed at the next meeting. Under the performance guarantee, it's noted that we may wish to require the applicant to present a performance guarantee for review. My inclination would be that I wouldn't want to see that, but I would certainly like to know the precedent of the board requiring that and the size of this subdivision and the nature of the improvements that they're proposing. If you could find that out for us, Maureen.
You have any comment, Maureen?
Yes, I certainly do. The whole intent of a performance guarantee is to give the town a guarantee, a promise that the things that are shown to be on the plan will be done. If there's anything on this plan that has to be done a particular way, in order to protect the public interest, then I would strenuously recommend that some kind of performance guarantee be presented to the board.
What would that be for in this case?
I would start right off with just the fact that you've got a driveway which is going to be the only access to these lots. If the road is not constructed as proposed, if it's not constructed as wide as it's proposed, there may be some question about emergency vehicle access. The board has been concerned, and that there are wetland protection issues involved with how the road is constructed adjacent to the wetland. If there is not the right kind of erosion control put in, there could be a serious detriment to that wetland area. These are the kind of things that if the applicant or the developer does not do those things in a proper manner, the town always has the option of using the letter of credit to make sure those things are in place. If there is no letter of credit and these things are not done in an appropriate manner, there is only legal recourse, mm-hmm. which means that nothing's going to happen out there, and whatever is not done right is just going to continue to deteriorate.
Could I ask the applicant whether it has any, or he has any position on the performance guarantee?
Well, our intention was that simply due to the fact that it's, you know, it's not a town road, it's a private road, you know, we are obviously sympathetic to emergency vehicles and all, and it behooves us to have the road constructed, you know, to the approved width prior to sale and such like that, that we were, you know, we were not really looking forward to giving a performance guarantee based simply on the fact that if it's not constructed, you know, to that it would become, you know, private liability versus a town's liability, simply because it technically doesn't have any public access.
Have you done any preliminary studies to find out what we would be talking about in the way of a performance guarantee if we were to proceed down that road?
It would simply depend. I mean, performance guarantee is what? What's the definition of performance guarantee? I guess the total cost of construction.
Of the project.
Yeah. No, we haven't done any total cost of the construction. Ballpark, it'd be, you know, probably over $15,000 to come up with a, you know, gravel drives and erosion controls and buried utilities. It'd be, you know, substantial amount of money to, you know, set aside for a possibility of several years before some of these lots would be sold, or, you know, or we'd be out, you know, out of the project. It's a lot of money.
Mr. Edsel?
I think the fact that they were considering public access waiver and that there are standards to the public access waiver that we're referring to, I don't think the board has any choice but to require a performance guarantee. And that would be an issue that in an amount that is acceptable to the town manager and planner,
town engineer.
Further discussion? Ms. Lardner?
I think I would agree with that. I would like to see some figures come in the next meeting.
Do I hear a motion?
Are we going to get a motion to either table us or approve us or what, you know, without some sort of guidance on the open space, overall general opinion, straw vote, anything besides?
Madam Chair, I don't think
we're
going to
come back
straw
next
votes,
time and do this all over again, or you know, what's...
I think our motion, I mean, we typically make a motion. There are times when we list items that which appear to be the consensus the board issues. And then the general discussion that has taken place, the notes from those are to give the applicant guidance. Though I would assume that a motion would give some guidance, or we can add those in short discussion after the motion.
I just want to, you know, start narrowing down these things, because it's like the engineering review. They go through the engineer review once, and then the next time they look at it, it's the same, basically the same plan, and there's yet some more comments. And I'd like to kind of just get everything in one basket.
You and I are on the same wavelength on that one, and I suspect that the rest of the board members are too. What I simply don't have a feel at this point of where the different board members are, and one way of trying to get more guidance is to request a motion and see what that motion comes up with, unless somebody else has a way of discussing things further. I think we will try to give you as much guidance tonight as we possibly can about what the concerns of the board are, so we will not have to start from square one next time. That's not anybody's intent. Judy?
I'll try. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Shaw Sprague for minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers for Ram's Head, a four-lot subdivision located off of Charles E. Jordan Road, be tabled to the regular August 18, 1992 meeting of the Planning Board with the mutual consent of the applicant. It is the board's desire that the plans be revised to reflect comments made by the town engineer and code enforcement officer, that the issue of naming the private roadways and numbering of units be worked out with the public safety department, and that the applicant work with the town, the conservation commission, perhaps I'd say the town planner and the conservation commission, to see what you can propose in the way of public access. I'm just going to leave the motion at that.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second the motion.
Discussion?
I don't know if it's appropriate. What I just said about working out, I hate to get in these situations where we ask you to look at some issue and you come back and you say we don't want to do it, and then you get the feeling from the board that you're going to be voted against if you don't do it, so you say okay, we're going to look at it, and you go back and then you come back with something else. I would like to see you put forth your best proposal when you come back to us next time, so we don't get into that sort of situation, if you can provide it. And I understand what you're saying, trying to get a sense of what the board wants. I do understand that.
I mean, I don't know how far we're going to work it out, you know, so. You go ahead.
My client has asked me to tell you that, plain and simply, we don't intend to wish to provide public access to this project. So I appreciate your motion, but we just don't want to do it. We're not going to do it. And I'm requesting that the board simply drop that as a condition. Or drop consideration of it as a condition. On the open space issue, again, we're asking the board to make a finding that there is no deficiency and therefore the requirement shouldn't be imposed. If there is a deficiency, I'd like it quantified. I think the record needs to reflect in a quantifiable manner what the deficiency is that this board finds this project is creating. So I want to be perfectly clear and let Shaw speak if he so desires. I think Shaw has demonstrated, and it's irrelevant to this project, but I'll say it anyway, I think Shaw has demonstrated in the past his desire to foster these sorts of things in this community. This particular project is unique. It is the only piece, if you will, of what people commonly refer to as the Sprague Corporation Holdings that is not held by the Sprague Corporation. It is a private piece of property. It currently has no public access other than what exists by way of the right to land on the beach, to fish and fowl, and the thing so clearly spelled out in the Bell case by the law court. In my opinion, your provision is in direct violation with the holding in the Supreme Court in the Nolan case. You are asking this applicant, suggesting that this applicant as a condition of approval must permit the public to come on his property. Now, there's no more fundamental right, and it's discussed in the cases, and I can cite them to you, and I won't tonight, but I'll cite them to Corporation Counsel if you so desire. But there's no more basic right than the right to keep people off your property that you don't want there. Now, I think it's a laudable public good. We're doing the same thing in South Portland. We're paying for them in South Portland. We're paying for these easements. It's a good. Nobody disputes the fact that it would be nice to have everybody have the right to get on, through private property to get to the ocean. But what I'm suggesting to you is that that's inappropriate unless the applicant so desires to cooperate in that fashion. And this particular applicant simply does not want to provide public access to the project. He cannot provide public access to this project, although that's not the reason why we don't want to do it. I mean, it's not possible. We're surrounded by public property. I mean, private property. We cannot have access of the public through the Sprague Corporation property. At this point, Shaw Sprague simply does not desire to permit public access on this project. In the future, if the town wishes to pursue public access across these lots, I certainly would encourage the town to enter into negotiations with the ultimate lot owners and perhaps purchase the rights. But I'm suggesting to you that it's inappropriate in this case. I'm not prepared, and certainly don't want to argue the merits of the ordinance. We're simply not going to do it. So your motion, if you want some guidance from us, the motion is inappropriate because we're not at this point going to enter into discussions on that concept.
Madam Chair, I don't think the motion is inappropriate at all. And I understand that Mr. Schnee represents his client and has to make a legal stand. We can make a motion as we wish. Whether they choose to present us with a plan providing access is their choice. We're making that suggestion. I understand. I guess one of the most difficult parts of the presentation all along has been, for some reason, your presentation has had a sense that, yeah, we're willing to do this. That's no problem. Our intent is make it a part of the plan. There was a lot of compromise involved in accepting or rejecting plans. But to simply say, well, yeah, that's no problem, we'll do that. I've had the sense of sloughing off on a number of issues, and I don't see why we should do that with this application any more than we would on any other. As far as proving deficiency, perhaps our town council, our town legal council, might give us some guidance there. I don't see how that is clearly evident to me here that we have to prove that to the applicant. Maybe we do. I don't think that's the issue. I think we simply have made a motion here. It's a perfectly legitimate motion to make. If the applicant chooses to proceed along those lines and to those recommendations, that's fine. If they don't, I'm sure we'll vote in future meetings on the application.
Let me say what I'd like to at this point. I heard the motion as a motion to table, and I thought that the discussion thereafter was a suggestion to the applicant to try to be as clear as that particular board member could be about what she saw as the salient points. Perhaps I'd like to say at this point that I don't believe that I am prepared to vote as one board member on the application tonight because I would frankly like to have a chance to request that the town planner, through the town manager if necessary, see whether we want to get some advice from council on this matter. And I would like to suggest, in view of the importance of the situation, and the question really both to the applicant and to the planning board, that it would behoove all of us to approach it in a thoughtful manner, which is probably not tonight. Could I get a clarification of your motion, that the motion was simply a motion to table with the mutual consent of the applicant until the regularly scheduled August meeting? Was that the motion, Judith?
That's not the motion I made. I am very happy if Steve would want to agree to end my motion at the sentence with the mutual consent of the applicant. You had asked for some guidance. I was trying to summarize the issues. My intent was not to say this board or this member expects you to go negotiate public access. This is an issue that will be discussed next time. I am personally not going to be offended if you tell us next meeting what you just told us now. I think you have to realize that what you say tonight is not going to end this issue for the board, and it will be discussed, and you should be prepared. But I can word that motion either way.
I just need to...
Charles, would you stand up if you're going to talk to us?
Hi, I'm Shaw Spray. And I guess I came away from the last meeting with a different idea and sense of where we were going and some kind of understanding of what the plan was based on what was presented. I learned about the changing and the on Thursday, which didn't give a great deal of time to come to grips with some of the issues that you put forward. One thing that has been difficult is working out an agreement with the Sprague Corporation. For me to go back now to the Sprague Corporation and ask that they give public access through their property, I just know that isn't something at that point they would want to do. I think the Sprague Corporation has been very generous to the town in the areas that the town uses, whether it's around Great Pond or Crescent Beach or whatever. One of my real concerns is that sometimes that we talk on both sides. The dune area is a very fragile area. It's something that the family has been very sensitive to keep itself off. We've put fencing there, we put signs there, we've seeded it. It moves, it erodes. To now come on and say, well, this is what we want, is a very difficult way to go and negotiate, which is my point to you. There are other places, I am sure, that the corporation would be interested in working with the town. I know I've done that. This is one area which I cannot agree with the public having access there. I know that I'm not going to change. What I need now is to see what my alternatives are going to be, because I don't want to come back, present the same thing that I'm presenting tonight, and hear the same discussion. I'd like to really have a sense of what the board is going to do over this this public access deal. And I really think that's only fair to ask of you.
Madam Chair.
Mr. Edson?
Ms. Loudner made the motion and sort of at the request of the applicant gave direction as to what we're looking for. If the applicant doesn't want that direction, I certainly don't mind as the person seconding the motion to remove those suggestions from the motion.
So we now have a motion, as I understand it, simply to table to the August meeting with the mutual consent of the applicant, but I don't know whether we have the consent of the applicant at this point.
To just table the same discussion for another month from now? Is that what I'm hearing, or what?
That's the motion, yes. And
let me just ask a question. Is it the board's intent to require public access?